pleased to announce, I know most of you have already heard, but I'm very pleased to announce, and Karen, if you could flip to the second slide, please, or the third slide, that from the 20, the sites have been narrowed down to 11 to receive anywhere between 1.75 million and just over 3 million. And Spokane County has been selected as one of the top 11 sites for the Safety and Justice Challenge.
You can imagine it was some 4.5 years ago that on Friday morning, believe it or not, and the county commissioners are not here today, that we started to get together on Friday mornings between the city and the county commission and talk about ways that we could collaborate. Interesting enough, I brought it up the other day, our admin committee, our executive committee for this group meets on Fridays, which, why? Because we got started on the last Friday of every month talking about ways to collaborate. And one, in all honesty, was scraps, how we take care of our animals. And then the second one was, well, do you think we could ever come together, not only from the commission on the executive side and the administration, but obviously all the elected officials today, those of you that are here as professionals in this field, and really come together. And I'll tell you, many a day it was thought that couldn't happen. And I'll tell you now, on a monthly basis, some 4 to 5 hours of my time is spent in an area that is not an area of expertise for me personally, but one that was right in front of us as I came in, and that was in the first budget that I assumed the city had decided to send its incarcerated to another county. And we made a commitment that we removed that from the budget, which was a $750,000 hit to our budget, and figure out how we could make that difference if we committed to this. I do want to start with a huge thank you to Dr. Van Wormer and all of you, but it was also three citizens that came together. All three of them are in this room that were appointed by the County Commission, by the City Council, and myself, and that was Jim McDevitt, of course, our esteemed colleague on the bench, Judge Murphy, and Dutch Wetzel, that came together for quite some time, meeting with many of you in this room and so many others. And what was fascinating when I read the Blueprint for Reform is to see all the centers of excellences throughout the system and really highlighting these centers of excellence. But really, how do we bring them together? How do we learn from each other? How do we make each other better from those centers of excellence? And I think that really set an amazing foundation for us. These things are not easy. The work that's been going on over the last 4 years is a ton of work, but to see the people coming together in really in a way that as I sat there in receipt of the Blueprint for Reform, and not only that, but the resolution that started that commission was to look at a more effective system. I think especially those of us at the city, and as we talk about creating the city of choice, it really has to do of treating our citizens with dignity and respect, but ultimately to come back as fruitful citizens. And how do we do that? And for me, is the recidivism rate and the cost thereof. It is our top priority. Just met with two elected officials this morning, and their top priority continues to be public safety. But in that, then how do we do it in a way that benefits all of us? So all of you that come here together, that make our judicial system, our criminal justice system what it is, from the frontline patrol officer to the superior court judge to the bailiff to the to those that are in parole and everybody in between, have a huge role in something that makes our system fundamentally different than the rest of the world. And it doesn't all mean that everybody's supposed to be on the same sheet of music in the sense of you represent different interests, but we truly are on the same set of music when we talk about the outcomes we want, and that is a safer community. I talk about being a safer community, the safest city of our size. You all make it part of that, which is in an inspiring way when you talk about the people, because the judicial system, the criminal justice system is 100% people. There's a lot of technology out there, there's a lot of equipment, there's a lot of everything, but the reality is it's people that administer it, and it's the people that are clients. And so as we talk about being safer, it has to be in a way that takes that into account. It definitely makes us stronger as a community, and as we do safer, stronger, smarter, I'll tell you, we're being recognized today by the country because of all of you and making the system smarter than really seeing this. And what I thought was intriguing, and I'll finish with this, is as we endeavored to do this, and Dr. Van Wormer brought this opportunity to us, what was interesting was this is an investment by the MacArthur Foundation. They actually, it is not a grant to say, go, you're in a disaster, you're in a, it was quite the opposite. I more than once counseled, if this is a disaster, it's an emergency, this is not a good time to put these resources. So no, it is a solid foundation that needs that capital, that venture capital, to take some amazing ideas, some centers of excellence, and put them through and make them systematic. And we all know when we do that, it may take a short infusion of capital to make long-term success in a more effective system, and one that our citizens can afford. Because I think as we look at any of these systems, we need to take that into account. And I would say, especially with the clients that are served, often there's a huge cross-link to poverty, and those that are paying for this are the very people that are, in many cases, the very people that are part of the system, and we need to take that into perspective, that this cannot keep on costing more effectively. We need to really focus on how do we effectively use the resources that the very citizens that ask us to do this are paying for. And so I appreciate where we're going, and really, as we see here on a monthly basis, the centers of excellence, as we can systematically put those throughout the system. Not only that, but to see this so holistically, from those of you that are here from the community, community advocates, to those of you who are in uniform, and those of you that are elected in education and otherwise, I don't think it exists. I know, in this area, this much collaboration across jurisdictions and across specialties. So thank you very much, congratulations, and you're exactly right, Dr. Van Wormer. I think the tough work begins, right? With that, I'll be followed by the council president.
I'm just saying, I'm really excited about this grant, because for the past 6 months, we've been doing a lot of discussion about a disproportionate impact of the system on communities of color. And we have two things now that we've been discussing for the last 6 months about how we would implement if we didn't get the grant, and that's the Racial Equity Toolkit, and then training with assistance from the Burns Institute and the Center for Social Inclusion. And if we look at our statistics, the average length of stay in 2014 was 17 days. The initial support from the MacArthur Foundation allowed us to dig deeper into our data. African Americans, the average length of stay was 25 days, Native Americans 21 days, and Latinos and Hispanics 22 days. And so I think we've got some good work to do, but we actually have the support necessary to address that problem in our system.
Just in a nutshell, what is this grant for? I mean, what does it do?
I'll take that one.
You'd like me to?
Go ahead. No, Jackie, go ahead.
Why don't I'll take this one, and then I'm going to have to jump off.
Go
so
ahead.
The grant is focused on four core areas, or the investment. So first, we're going to be building a robust pretrial department. The second is that we're going to be adopting what's called a risk assessment tool, so that we're going to be basically taking a closer look at the system, and rather than just relying on past criminal history or information regarding their past failures to appear, we're going to use a tool that actually predicts their likelihood for failure to appear based on numerous factors. So it gives us a score of high, moderate, or low risk for reappearance or for recidivism. And so by using these tools, we can more greater safely decide who can be in the community safely under pretrial supervision and who needs to continue to be detained. The other piece we're going to be building is more access to diversionary opportunities for low-level, low-risk offenders. And then finally, we're going to be addressing the overlap that we have between our three court systems by building a portability team. So what we often see is high rates of failure to appear for court or warrants going out because there's confusion among what court this individual is supposed to appear in. They might be arrested and cited for both a felony and a misdemeanor and a violation and end up in numerous different courts all around the same time period. So we're going to be combining those cases into one court with one judge, one prosecutor, one public defender, across the three court systems to ease the burden on the defendant, make it more manageable, and make it almost sort of therapeutic in a sense, so we can get to know those cases a little bit more closely.
So the big push, of course, is the pretrial population. Just to kind of dumb this down just a little bit, statistics and the data show that 65% of the people that are held in the county jail are held pretrial, meaning they haven't gone to court, they haven't been found guilty, they're not there serving a sentence. It's problematic, you know, for many reasons, considering they're innocent until proven guilty. But more problematic is the fact that the only way they can get out of jail is by posting a bond. They've got to come up with cash. The people that are sitting in the jail pretrial are people who cannot come up with the cash. Consequently, that results in over-incarceration of minorities, of people of color, and that's problematic.
What's the fix for that, though? If somebody does need a bond but they can't afford it, is there a workaround?
Well, that's what this grant is intended to focus on. The big chunk of the money from MacArthur is going to be invested in hiring additional pretrial services staff. Right now we have a pretrial services department that consists of maybe five people, and all they can do at this particular period of time is to assess them and give recommendations to the court for release. What a more robust pretrial department will do is will include additional, I believe, eight employees who will basically be actually supervising and monitoring. So, for example, if a person comes into court and they're arrested, we'll say a property crime, they don't have much of a prior history, but they have a history of not showing up for court. That's problematic because we don't know if they're going to show up for court again. So right now, all we can do is either release them without any bond, or we can set a bond. If they can't afford a bond, they don't get out. With the more robust pretrial services department, we can now release them on supervision by one of these employees, who will then monitor them, who will call them with reminders for court, will check up on them, will have them report. Many different conditions can be in place, and that will assure the court, at least, that they will return for court.
About how many jobs do you think this will open up in Spokane County?
Well, I think the plan for the funds is to hire, I think it's eight additional. You might have the
it's
exact
actually
number.
From the grant to what we got awarded, about $1.75 million was the award. We wrote the grant, I think, for a full $3 million. So it hires six pretrial officers and mental health social worker positions, one and a half. But we also, DSHS state funding has also come through for another two pretrial officers.
Will the actual facility, the Spokane County Jail, be upgraded at all? What are the...
Well, we're actually talking about putting a courtroom in the jail right now. Do you want to talk about facilities, Commissioner O'Quinn, since you're on the Facilities Committee?
Sure. Can you hear me okay?
You bet.
So the city and the county in a previous, SRLJC meeting, we moved forward the courtroom idea. It will not be funded out of this grant, but the city and county have already committed to taking that next step in developing the courtroom inside the jail. And the actual question about whether we're going to be investing in a jail, which is probably where this is going, is that the whole idea behind the grant is actually to reduce the population in our jail by 21% over the next 3 years. And when you take a look at the work that we're doing around the blueprint for reform recommendations, you take a look at the work that we're doing now with the MacArthur Foundation grant, our goal will be to reduce those numbers and then reassess our needs in the future. So we will be making some capital investments, but it will not be in a new jail building.
What would a courtroom in the jail add? What would be different about that?
Well, do you want to answer that, Shelley?
Judge, you can go ahead and answer that since you're present. That's easier.
Yeah, and I'll answer it from maybe a different perspective than the facilities perspective. Right now, we have to bring all of the inmates over to the courtrooms, and that costs people. It's time consuming, and there has to be individuals that will actually transport them. So for felonies, they have a policy where one felon per two transport officers. It slows down the system, it bogs down the system. I think part of the idea behind building a courtroom in the jail would be for ease of access, and it goes hand in hand with another of our goals for the MacArthur funds, and that would be to create that portability team. So we'd have one judge, one defender, one defendant, one inmate, and one prosecutor. We'd all go over to the jail, making the ease of transporting and adjudicating that individual quicker, faster, better turnaround time, perhaps help to aid in reducing the jail population.
Again, as you can see, many of these things, especially from the administrative side, we were seeing double-digit increases in the cost of the criminal justice system at large. Everything from the patrol officer all the way through the bench, and really looking, and the judge just spoke to one of those, is having those transport officers, how do you utilize, what's a better way of utilizing them, and that was an obvious one. And so as you look at, and what you even hear about the capital expenditures, it was a pause. It was, if we're gonna do the capital expenditures, let's make sure they're in the areas of a smarter criminal justice system. And so that's exactly where, as we meet on a monthly basis now and have for a couple of years, the committees review these items, but it is the facilities matching a better best business practice. It's not redoing things and keeping up with programs that we know are not the best way of doing it. And that's what I think is exciting about the MacArthur Foundation, is we have peer cities out there. We had 22 or 20 and now 11, and to see and have an expert and now a co-funded position that you don't see very often between county government and city government, but in Dr. Van Wormer, of really looking at this as a community issue. Different entities have different responsibilities, and again, whether that be the city, the judicial branch, the legislative branch, the executive branch, but to see us come together and fund those ideas that are really a smarter way of doing it, or smarter justice. And then what's exciting is to see the community groups that are really rallying around this, whether a smart justice, whether you see law enforcement there, because they knew that this, many days, this wasn't the right way to do what they're doing. So you have a clear alignment between law enforcement, the prosecutors, the bench, the administration, the defendants, and smarter ways of providing justice for our community.
Some people might see the stats and think, oh, there was going to be 21% more inmates back on our streets. Should we be afraid? Can we put those fears kind of at ease that these are the least likely to...
Well, so if you look at some of the... Oh, did you want to address this, Commissioner O'Quinn?
Sorry, yes, I would. This is not about being soft on crime. This is really about being smart about and assessing the risks and the needs of those in our jail, and ensuring that we have the right folks in jail, and that those who are not a risk for our community, putting them out on some of the other options, so that we are running an efficient, effective criminal justice system that taxpayers can afford. I apologize for the music in the background. So it really is about being smart about who we are keeping in jail and keeping the right folks in jail.
And exactly, you'd rather not have the jail filled with people that are very low risk, and then have somebody
Correct.
That's being brought in by one of our officers of the city and not be able to put them in because the jail is full. And so this is critical to make sure those that need to be in jail, that are a risk, that show by the tool that will be developed through this process, are a high risk, or those that are, are found by our police officers that were, that they, because of their history and otherwise. And that's where you see, as especially in the city of Spokane, where you see our prolific criminals. And we've talked about that a lot. And what you don't want is to release those that have a high propensity to recommit a crime, because you're holding somebody in on that's a low risk but doesn't have the ability to post that bond.
It's also about pretrial services being really robust, though, because a high percentage of people that are in jail are just there for a failure to appear. And so if we have better services pretrial that follow up with people, actually give them a reminder to come to court, then they're going to come to court instead of getting a failure to appear and then ending up in jail on that for another charge. And so just by being smarter about how we operate, we can also decrease the jail population.
And you had talked about supervised release. I know that is an option that is used in some cases. Oh, and you said that was going to be one of the things that we could see maybe more of that. Is that?
Well, there might be. There's a misperception. There is no supervised release in Spokane. We don't have a pretrial services department that offers any kind of supervision. We do have a monitored program, but that's really basically an inmate getting out of custody and reporting once a week. What we're talking about is actually some affirmative action taken by these individuals who are trained and skilled, depending upon the population they're supervising, offering them services, checking up on them, assisting them, getting them some services. Now that helps in a wide array of circumstances, not just getting them back to court, not just having them answer to their criminality, but hopefully in reducing recidivism. A lot of these people are homeless. A lot of these people have no food, they have nothing. That doesn't excuse their behavior, but you know, hopefully we can create a situation where we're investing some upfront money versus on the way out the door, as we have been doing.
What does this mean for property crime? Because that is a nonviolent offense, but at the same time, that impacts a lot of people, and a lot of the property crime offenders, at least that I see, are repeat offenders.
You got to keep in mind that much of the reform that we're talking about initiating is not meant for the high-risk individual. It's not meant for the individual who's been in the system forever and is looking at going to prison. We're not talking about that level of an offender. Just because they're so-called property crimes does not mean that they're low risk. So this is geared toward the lower risk individual who is not a risk to the community, but really is high needs, meaning, again, just what I said, they're homeless, they have no money, they're drug addicted, they're mentally ill. There's a huge focus that's gonna be, a lot of attention that's gonna be paid toward folks that are mentally ill. The stats, the data show that, 80%, 60%?
85% of those in our jail have a mental illness.
Right, and so those
85?
Are folks.
85% have
right.
Some diagnosable mental
and,
illness.
And there's gonna be a focus on those individuals and trying to get them some services and meeting their needs.
What do you think Spokane was chosen?
Two of the things we heard was the community involvement was really strong in Spokane compared to the other 20 sites, because half of the sites got eliminated. And the other thing, we really called out racial equity and the disparities in our system, and actually had the racial equity toolkit built into our grant proposal and had training built in, and nobody else called it out as explicitly as we did in their proposals.
Can I also add, I think what's also important about this is that Spokane has been doing this work for the last couple of years. We're not initiating or launching this initiative because of the MacArthur Foundation grants. We have already been working on it. We had the blueprint report done a couple of years ago, 2013. And so I think the fact that we have a history of a community that is already committed to making change, coupled with the items that Ben just talked about, made a very strong application.
So when will we start to, when will you get the money, when will changes?
I don't know, but I got a meeting at noon tomorrow to talk about how we're going to implement some changes.
My understanding is it's very quick. That'll somehow get wired into whatever the account is within the next week or two.
Oh, great.
Yeah.
Checks in the mail.
Yeah.
You know, and I think it's and the judges talked about some of these key issues, really a holistic approach, and housing being one of those. And so as we, and homelessness being one of those, and as we see this issue of homelessness, we see those that are in the criminal justice system. By having a strong criminal justice system, it allows us in other departments and other facets and agencies of the city to then make changes in our investments. Whether it was 2 years ago, we changed our philosophy of the city for a housing first model. And you see now another 100 units. We have 50 units now. You'll have another 100 units of those that are chronically homeless. We have the Hotspotters program as a partnership with the community and with our fire department of really going out and addressing those that may have mental illness and chronically inebriated or other issues, and working with them. And we're finding, even in last year alone, as we monitored 12, we saw some $60,000 in savings. When we started this with the blueprint reform, it was based off of a jail per day cost of somewhere around $135 to $150, and everybody knew there was a better way to spend those dollars per day than putting somebody in jail that may be low risk. It also then facilitates the ability to make sure that those that deserve to be in jail and rightfully so by the court system or because of day-to-day crime activity, that they're able to do that. So rather than, and we made a commitment when the council president and I came into office, as we were sitting there thinking as a city that we are now going to ship our inmates or our pretrial confined folks to another county just does not make sense. And so it was not an easy decision. It blew a $750,000 hole into our budget because we expected to see those savings because we were going to get charged, you know, some $60 a day. But the reality is this is a community issue. There's different players at the table that can come together to make this happen. Not only that, but it's over the last couple of years that our police department has the chronic offender unit. And you see these stories where officers are literally being caseworkers with some of our low-risk offenders and to help them find housing, help them find workforce development. We now have partnerships with nonprofits that are helping people get jobs. Jobs is the number one indicator of recidivism, of between that and housing, and so really being able to focus dollars and resources. At the end of the day, we want to reduce that recidivism. You want citizens that are contributing citizens, and at the same time, those that need to be incarcerated, that we have the space to put those in so that we can continue to bring down our crime rate, which we've seen huge success in that, but it's not just more officers. It is a much more robust system, one that works in a smarter way. But by having this strength here, it allows us in all the other areas then to build programs that build that. Ultimately, you don't want anybody in the system. That's your, so if we can have the police youth initiative and get kids before they may start getting into the process, that's your ultimate goal. But again, the key is then to also have a strong criminal justice system. And like I said earlier, there in the blueprint reform, it showed and highlighted so many centers of excellences that exist in our system today, but may not be coordinated in a way that gets the best outcome. And I really think that, I mean, our first mapping of this, I remember when Dr. Van Wormer came on and we mapped the first procedure. If you were arrested, what would happen? And it is quite a diagram, to say the least, and all the different decision points. But to have this come together is going to be very exciting.
I'm assuming it's also going to make our officers safer. You know, that jail is so overcrowded, and there's
21% in 3 years decrease. Yes,
that's the goal.
Mm-hmm. How does that work out in numbers? Like,
what's the average daily, Shelley? Commissioner O'Quinn. Over 800, and then a 21% decrease is what we committed to in the grant, though. Then we can decrease the overall cost of the system.
We started out with 10%, and I know at the time the figure was about, give or take, about 200 people. So okay. Now we're double that. So,
if for some reason you don't reach that goal, is there
a penalty? Do we have to give the money back?
Yeah.
Social impact.
No, and you know, and this is the second phase, and there's a third phase. And so hopefully we will do well enough to, you know, the good thing about MacArthur is that even if we hadn't received this grant, they would not have abandoned us. They still would have given us some, you know, assistance, technical assistance, that sort of a thing. So they don't, once they start something, they don't just kind of, you know, throw it away. So I'm confident we're going to reach those numbers. So that's not an issue.
Are there specific steps in place to address the racial inequalities in the jail, or will that be a side effect of some of these other programs that were...
Actually, there's two parts to the racial equity piece. The first is a racial equity toolkit. So think of that as a lens. And we actually practiced using the lens when we wrote the grant. And so we developed certain questions that every part of the grant proposal was run through those questions so that we see how the policy decisions that we're making are impacting racial equity in our system. Seattle, the city of Seattle has implemented this, the city of Madison, Wisconsin, and so there's some examples out there, and we'll be, as part of this grant, developing that so that every level of decision making that we make, any policy decisions that are made in the criminal justice system, include that lens on how it affects racial disparities in our system. And then the second thing is that this grant comes with a substantive amount of training on racial bias and racial inclusiveness. And every member of the criminal justice system will go through that training over the next 6 months. And so those are two impactful things. And those were what in other cities that didn't get the grant didn't really explicitly call out what they were going to do. And so We have a work group that meets every 3 weeks, and everybody's really excited to get moving on implementing those.
And then earlier, sorry, she said they're going to look at other factors besides failure to appear in criminal history. Do you know what those factors would be?
I said that?
No, she, I think it was Jackie. She said we're not just going to be looking at failure to appear in criminal history as a basis for...
Well, okay, so the court rule basically says you need to decide two things. One of them, are they a risk to the community, and are they a flight risk? So that's what the court rule tells you to look at. So if you look at somebody on paper, they got nowhere to live, that sort of a thing, and let's say they're a flight risk, the goal, of course, would to be able to handle these individuals and perhaps giving them some direction or some triaging is the word I like to use. They need a place to live, they need some money, they need some ID, sort of a place where they can go, such as like the community court where they can get some of those things, to get them into a position where they can safely be released into the community pretrial.
Functionally, one discussion as you talk about facilities is jail versus community corrections facility, and in that model, you have some of those other resources there. As the municipal bench has found out in the community court, the judge just referred to it, that her colleagues at the municipal level, ID is one of the critical issues. So now we have that resource at the criminal or at the community court, which of course is at our library, our downtown library. But these folks, they can't get housing because they don't have ID. They can't get another one is Social Security disability benefits, and well, they need the ID in order to start that, and they need a Social Security number so that they can get that. You know, so there's these issues, and that's why they're in front of the judge. You still hold them accountable if you've been to the community court, and I would imagine as we talk about the portable teams, we talk about implementing that sort of idea at the other levels of district and superior court, the reality is the resources still need to be there. The intensity or the offense obviously warrants it to be at what level it is. But very similarly, and I mean, not to speak on behalf of the judge, you'll find some of these same things. And so the idea of having a community corrections facility, whereas some of these other agencies, and again, that's some of the issue of failure to appear, is you ask them to go do all this. Well, you're traveling all over the city. If you're homeless, if you don't have ID, if you don't have Social Security disability, because you then you're just from the get-go, you're so far behind. And so really, that's what, as we talk about resources going forward, we talk about, you know, investments in capital. I think the public expects, and I think rightfully so, that those are investments in smarter ways of administering justice. And I think that this will give us the basis to do that.
If someone is homeless, how do you keep track of them? For saying, you know, we're going to check in with them and call them and make sure they are appearing in court. If somebody's homeless, I'm guessing
that's a good question. That's why we have committees that are set up that have expertise in this kind of a thing. You know, I mean, there have been times when someone comes into court in a low level offense, they live with the Gospel Mission. Okay, that's where they've lived. So I let them out, and I cross my fingers and, you know, jump up and down and hope that they come back. You know, if you can start offering them some services like the ID, like a place to get food stamps, like a way to get their Social Security disability, they're interested in that. Those are the kinds of things that are going to keep them alive. If we can offer them that and offer that give and take, I'm not suggesting making it a friendlier type of a situation, because the criminal justice system is not a friendly type of a situation, but giving them the basics so that they can live, where, you know, if you're living in your car, your first thought is not getting to court. Your first thought is, how am I going to survive the night? So, you know, assisting in all of those basics, I think, is going to go a long way.
But you bring up a very good point. I know the council president and I are having discussions right now as we discuss this issue of homelessness and shelters. You know, one of our main shelters, the House of Charity, received some 40,000 pieces of mail on an annual basis last year. It was the state legislature, and I believe the leadership of one of our representatives, Kevin Parker, that allowed mail to get sent to and permanent, you know, mail slots to be sent at the shelters. And so that's what allows us to couple on top of each other, to where if we go to a system that allows us for other options besides in pretrial confinement, those other partners can then come on board and be a part of that. But right now, being so desperate, there's no way to bring that together. But that's what, especially on the homelessness side, is exactly what you could do. And or, as you look at other models that we're implementing in the housing area, to be a part of that. Or, like I said, housing is one of them, absolutely. The other one, especially, is workforce. But now we can work with those outside agencies to provide that workforce development training for this population. so that you know, the ultimate goal is for them not to recidivate. Well, thank you very much. We appreciate it. It's a great day for Spokane.
Check with Commissioner O'Quinn and see if she has any comments.
Commissioner O'Quinn, anything else from you?
Oh, no, I just, this is exciting for our community. So thank you for allowing me to join you via phone.